I think one of the wonders of birds is actually their ability to migrate. That's something that's intrigued people since Aristotle, who first remarked on this extraordinary pattern of birds coming and going with seasons. There are about 350 migratory bird species in North America, half of whom are declining in populations.
And in order to understand and develop conservation strategies, we need to be able to link breeding and wintering areas of migratory birds. You might think that people know where, at this point, with all the technology we have, that people know exactly where birds migrate to when they leave our own backyards. But if you take a bird book and you look at the map of where the wintering range of any particular species is, it's huge. And for the vast majority of birds, that's what we know. We know that they leave, and we know that they go somewhere, maybe between Mexico and Ecuador.
But there's no clear indication of where different populations, where different individuals might be going, you know? So if you have a range from, you know, across North America, does that mean that the birds in New York go to the same places that the birds in California? You really do need to be able to tag specific populations and follow them somehow to see, you know, where they winter.
The ability to track migratory birds has been a huge challenge for centuries, since people first noticed that birds migrate at all.
In terms of actually quantifying an individual's movements seasonally, it was really John James Audubon, who in 1803 tied some string onto an eastern peewee and found that the bird left in the fall and came back the following spring and still had the string on the leg.
Of course, he had no idea where the bird went in those intervening months. In the early 20th century, the U.S. Established the bird banding lab, which uses small, individually numbered bands you can put on the leg of a bird. It doesn't impact their movements or survival at all. It's a great tool, but the rate of return on those bands was really, really low.
The logistics of trying to recapture a bird, it's like looking for a needle in a haystack. How are you going to ever find that individual that you banded?
Then, with the miniaturization of electronics, people have started to put tracking devices on birds. But all these methods are very expensive, and you know, sample sizes tend to be very small.
And so what we really needed is a way to track birds where we could understand where hundreds of birds are going, thousands of birds are going. Back in the early 90s, you know, I was thinking, geez, you know, we have all these folks banding birds, and what if we were just to pull a single feather and put it in an envelope and store it? We would have a record of that individual's DNA. The genome of an animal is made up of four different classes of nucleotides, four letters of the DNA code. It's the arrangement of those four letters that is responsible for coding genes that produce the characteristics of the animals we see. And so in a migratory bird, there are a billion of these individual letters, and their arrangement in the genome differentiates one species from another, one population from another, one individual from another individual.
So we start by sequencing the entire genome. We line all of that data up using huge supercomputers to process this amount of data. And we do comparisons between populations, and we identify the particular base pairs that differ between the populations. We use use genetic markers called SNPs, which stands for single nucleotide polymorphisms, which are essentially A's, C's, T's, or G's that are unique to that particular population. In general, we can identify birds to populations with between 96 and 192 SNPs. So then the last step is to take DNA from feathers collected from the wintering grounds and screen those samples for the 96 or 192 unique genetic variants and assign them back to the breeding population that they're most likely from. In the old days, if you captured a bird on the wintering areas and it happened to have a metal leg band, if you were that lucky, then you might be able to tell where that bird was from.
Now we don't have to worry about that. You don't have to find the same individual.
Now we can take any individual captured on the wintering areas or anywhere along its migratory trajectory and tell you where that bird was from.
In the US, we have about 350 monitoring stations. In the neotropics, we have about 100 stations. And it's very easy, once you have a bird in the hand, to pull a feather and get the genetic information.
So suddenly that becomes very economical. Once you've done the basic genomic work, you can screen 300 feathers in a day, and you can do it for, maybe $6 to $8 per sample. The end product of the Bird Genoscape Project fundamentally is a map. A map that shows where populations are breeding, where they're overwintering, and they're also their migratory routes.
My vision is that through these maps, we can take the information about where the birds are going and turn that into targeted conservation or restoration efforts.
If we go back to the early 90s, it was kind of just a gut feeling that it was going to pay off. We just needed to start collecting this stuff. And now there's been this revolution in technology. And, we can begin to really get at the questions that we had been trying to answer for, 25 years.